Roberto Bolaño's The Savage Detectives. I started with an easy one. What is free verse, I said. My voice echoed inside the car as if I were speaking into a microphone. Something with no fixed number of syllables, said Bellino. And what else? Something that doesn't rhyme, said Lima. And what else? Something with no regular placement of stresses, said Lima. Good. Now a harder one. What is a tetrastich? What? Said Lupe beside me. A metrical system of four verses, said Bellino. And a syncope? Oh Jesus, said Lima. Please, sit back and enjoy today's edition of Lit Tips. The Savage Detectives focuses on a group of avant-garde poets in mid-1970s Mexico City calling themselves the Visceral Realists. Taking their name from a similar movement from the 1930s, their stated aim is to destroy the Mexican literary establishment. They seek to overturn convention at every opportunity and consider their great enemy to be the eminent Mexican poet Octavio Paz. Above all, they revere a poet from the original movement named Cesaria Tinajero. This is their mission, but what Bolaño is much more concerned with is their execution of it. The lens through which we are introduced to the Visceral Realists is Juan Garcia Madero, a 17-year-old university student. Garcia Madero attends a poetry workshop that is crashed by two poets, the Chilean Arturo Bellano and the Mexican Ulises Lima. After an argument with the workshop's professor, Bellano and Lima invite Garcia Madero to join their cause based on his shared love of real, authentic poetry. Bolaño, portrayed as Bellano in the book, based the Visceral Realists off the real-life infra-realist movement founded in Mexico City at the same time the novel takes place by himself and the Mexican poet and inspiration for Lima, Mario Santiago Papasquiaro. The novel serves as a thinly veiled fictional account of the movement's foundation and disillusion, and follows the lives of many of those involved over the next several years. Bolaño's tone is not one of wistful nostalgia for the glories of his youthful peers, nor is it a defeated resignation to history as it turned out, despite the efforts of those same young people to create what they thought would be a better world. His approach is much more nuanced. It introduces us to a group of people brought together under what at first appears to be a common cause, then shows us how their grand idealism is undone by petty jealousies, envies, unchecked egos, and all manner of other all-too-human trivialities. Lima and Bellano view themselves as standard bearers of literary authenticity. It is to their credit that in spite of their pretension, they can't be accused of creating the movement just for street cred. Their commitment is 100% earnest. Early on in the novel, a character remarks, "The Visceral Realists? Please. The only ones who read are Ulises and his little Chilean friend. The rest are a bunch of functional illiterates. As far as I can tell, the only thing they do in bookstores is steal books. Then they give the books to Ulises and Bellano, who read them and tell what they're about so the others can go around bragging about having read Cano, for example." The novel's first section follows Garcia Madero as his life is consumed by the Visceral Realist movement and its members. He writes and shares poems, reads the works of other members, obsessively reads the books others recommend, and engages in several trysts with women directly or tangentially involved with the movement. All the while, in the background, Bellano and Lima begin to expel unworthy members from the ranks, and a prostitute named Lupe fleeing for their lives into northern Mexico from Lupe's pimp and his associates. It's in the novel's second section that the true scope of Bolaño's vision starts to become clear. Abandoning Garcia Madero's narrative voice for dozens of others, we follow in chronological order anecdotes by characters who encountered either Bellano or Lima from 1976 until 1996. Presented in the form of interviews with names, dates, and specific locations, these narrators reveal the grand scale of the pair's travels. Interviews are conducted in North and South America, Europe, Africa, and the Middle East. Nearly all of the interviewees are less than favorable in their accounts. Expelled Visceral Realists, former friends, and jilted women are given as much time to air out their grievances as the occasional admirer. It's one thing for an author to create a surrogate for themselves in their work, another entirely to devote hundreds of pages to allowing surrogates of others he wronged or pissed off an opportunity to say exactly how they feel. The third and final section picks up where the first left off, and returns us to Garcia Madero's narration as he details a road trip through the Sonora Desert. The novel ends with Bellano and Lima going their separate ways to begin their travels detailed in the second section. A key theme of the novel is that literature, and by extension nothing else, is permanent. Whether Bellano and Lima realize this or not is uncertain. They revere genuine writers like Cesaria Tinajero, even though her work is unimaginably obscure. By contrast, they scoff at poets like Octavio Paz, a Nobel laureate whose work is in no danger of disappearing anytime soon. And this is, of course, not to argue that awards imply quality by any means. But it is an unfortunate truth that works and creators hailed by the establishment, or whatever you'd like to call it, regardless of merit, have an infinitely higher chance of staying in the public's peripheral vision than the work of writers known only to a small, devoted following. Bellino and Lima seem to believe that by resurrecting a forgotten fringe movement, they will be able to bring its beliefs and vision to a world more open to and in tune with its mission than in decades past. But in their steadfast refusal to accept anything associated to any degree with the, for lack of a better word, mainstream, they close themselves off to all but a tiny minority. And this tiny minority itself mainly consists of trendy types using their affiliation with the latest avant-garde craze as an excuse to get high, get laid, and get out in search of the next cool thing. The movement's goal is by design and approach, unattainable. Or maybe not. Maybe it's as Lima says when asked why the visceral realists are being purged, all just a joke. Lima and Bellino hold literature sacred above all else, including, and maybe even particularly, human relationships. It is this deep reverence for the written word that simultaneously creates a magnetic aura around them which draws others to join their movement, and then sets in motion the disintegration of the visceral realists once Lima and Bellino decide to start weeding out the posers who can't be bothered to aspire to their level of commitment. Unlike his ancient namesake, Ulysses, and Bellino, have no concrete or even imagined goal toward which they spend their wandering years striding. Their quest is for something intangible, ephemeral, undefinable. At the end of the road, there is no El Dorado, no Dulcinea del Toboso, no Ithaca. And maybe the novel is to some degree Bolaño's way of admitting that he knows this devotion, this unwavering obsession embodied by Lima and himself through Bellino is beyond the realm of reason for the average person more concerned with practical matters. For example, Lima in one passage is found reading a book of poetry wrapped in plastic while taking a shower, seemingly unable to step away from poetry for even a few minutes at a time as if the book were an IV drip. Another section finds Bellino becoming so indignant with the Spanish literary critic that he, in a Quixotic move, challenges him to a sword fight on a beach. Bolaño plays up the inherent ridiculousness of the situation, and Bellino is denied in his quest to deliver justice to the critic. Their duel devolves into an inept contest involving two absurd men unversed in swordplay going at it, in the narrator's words, like stupid children. So in the end, was it worth it? Was Bellino and Lima's stubborn refusal to give an inch to ideas and preconceptions of literature that didn't exactly match their own worth the decades of aimless wandering and loneliness? Were they, as they believed, objectively the literary world's only true arbitrators of good taste, despite having managed to alienate others with their ideas and conduct in several countries across multiple continents? Challenged on this, the two would likely say that yes, it was, and yes, they were. Neither Bellino nor Lima are shown to ever achieve any kind of notable success in the decades covered in the novel, and because of their belief that success is synonymous with selling out, maybe this was indeed their goal all along. Further complicating matters is the assertion at the end of Bolaño's final work, 2666, that the narrator is in fact Arturo Bellino. Is this an implication that this one massive work, already considered a classic of 21st century literature, was the product of Bellino's years of wandering, a way of giving Bellino the last word against the critics? Bolaño passed away at 50 from liver failure in 2003. He left behind a considerable amount of work that is still yet to be published, as well as a lingering sense that we'll never truly know who he was. Not only did he freely mix actual and invented experiences in his work, he went out of his way to lie about his life in interviews. For instance, he claimed to have struggled with a non-existent heroin addiction and, like Bellino, made dubious claims of being arrested in 1970s Chile by the Pinochet regime. Not gaining widespread success until late in life, Bolaño took advantage of the new platforms offered him to make no secret of his opinions of other writers. While there were plenty of peers whom he admired, he could be particularly harsh when it came to the sacred cows of Latin America, earning no shortage of detractors. For example, he called Gabriel Garcia Marquez, a man terribly pleased to have hobnobbed with so many presidents and archbishops. Isabel Allende was a scribbler whose attempts at literature ranged from kitsch to the pathetic, and he summed up Mario Vargas Llosa as the same sort of sycophant as Marquez, but smoother. If you're going to say what you want to say, you're going to hear what you don't want to hear. With The Savage Detectives and its collage of self-eviscerating narrators, Bolaño beat his critics to the punch by doing most of the heavy lifting for them ahead of time. We hope that you enjoyed this edition of Lit Tips. As always, please like this video. If you haven't already, subscribe to our channel, check out our other videos, and leave a comment with your thoughts on this video along with suggestions for any books or authors you would like us to cover in future episodes. Until next time, keep reading.